Ball State. We're a teachers college. We have a business college, a regional university. And we basically didn't have an online presence at all in the business college until maybe a few years ago. And these are the first economics classes developed for online. Now, we had distance learning, which was more of a correspondence. It just didn't work well, and students were doing it on their own time. So the university decided we're going to convert the distance ed courses all to semester cohort online courses. Since I was doing the distance ed course, they said, would you like to do the online version of this? I said, absolutely. I know online is the future. I want to be in with that trend. I don't want to be left behind. And even though I'm a little, I don't want to say I'm low tech. I think I'm pretty high tech, but I'm what you might call a late adopter. This is my cell phone. Basically, the process for me is converting what I do in the classroom directly to online. So in the classroom, I do lectures. And I want to make the lecture as much interactive as I can. Although I'm pretty old school, just talking. I like talking to the students. I like telling them stories. But I like to ask them questions. And I'm the kind of person who will ask a question. I'll just sit there until somebody answers. Then I give assignments, quizzes, and, well, reading assignments, of course. And I'm not talking about the reading assignments because there's really no transition there for online. You just assign the same reading, so you do it on your own time. But homework assignments and quizzes have to be administered online. I'll talk a little bit about that. And then give exams to test that the students have learned it. So that's a pretty traditional classroom format. And transitioning to that online, well, you just replace the lecture with the lecture video. The assignments, I've added discussion forums to capture the discussion aspect, the Q&A aspect, the interactive aspect of lectures. So that is an additional element. The assignments are just administered online, but they don't really have to be different in my experience. In fact, I assign the same homework sets to my online students as I do to my classroom students. And then exams, proctored the tools to create online lecture videos. It's actually not a lot of stuff. Two main hardware items is the headset mic. You've got to have a quality mic, and it's got to be a mic that's close to your face. I tried my first ones with my built-in mic on my laptop, and the sound quality was terrible. Sound quality is really key here, so you gotta have a mic right in front of your face. Fortunately, they're very easy to get, they're not expensive. My school also supported me with providing all the equipment, so that was nice. And then the drawing tablet, and I have the bamboo here, which I love. It's a little hard to get used to, but once you get used to it, this thing is beautiful. It serves primarily as a whiteboard. You can do a lot of things with the pen. You can select different colors, you can highlight, you can draw, you can do all sort of colors. And then you can erase with the eraser. It's so natural once you get the hang of it. I'm not really that artistic, so I don't draw pictures with it, but I draw as if I'm drawing on a whiteboard, definitions, concepts, and then graphs, and I can walk the students through the graphs. I can change the color during that. So this is very useful and actually very fun once you get the hang of it. And then as far as software goes, I use a good screen capture and video editor tool called Camtasia. It's what you see when you open up Camtasia. You choose the options, how much of the screen you want to record. Do you want to record a mic? Do you want to record the system? I usually have my mic and my system because I'll play little videos and I want it to capture the video. But you've got nice options in your record, and then it's got a very nice editing tool. It's a little tricky to learn, but very user-friendly. So I do this all myself, all the editing and production myself. And then I should have put Word up here as well. I use Word a little bit, but PowerPoint is the main vehicle. This is Alex discussed for presenting my slides, pictures, animations. Excel and then Word also, because with the Bamboo, it's compatible with Office. So I can draw in PowerPoint. So if I need a whiteboard, I just leave a blank slide in PowerPoint. So I have pictures, I have slides with tables, with definitions, with pictures. And then if I want to do some whiteboarding, I just leave a blank slide as I'm scrolling through my PowerPoint, recording on my headset. Same with Excel. I'll use a lot of spreadsheets that show things like calculating unemployment rates, calculating inflation rates. I have this little simple price index, simple GDP tables. So I think I did a pretty good job with my content, and I'll show you some examples. And I think I did a good job with giving feedback on homework, making the homework hard enough to make the students work, to create a derived demand for the content. And then giving them personal, directed feedback, one-on-one, which I think is essential, as I'll explain. And I'm going to show you some comments from the students, and I'm a little shy about this, actually, because you're going to think, wow, that Watts has a big head and he's really tuning his own horn. But this is just to demonstrate that, you know, what works works well and the students appreciate it. And to balance it out, let me show you all the things I did wrong. I built the course as the semester was unfolding. Oh, that's the wrong way to do it. So I was constantly behind. I had a list of dates, and I had to keep pushing due dates back because I didn't have things ready, because it does take a lot of time to produce quality content. I was so focused on content that I often let emails slip through, didn't communicate, didn't have clear guidelines for the students. Some of my videos are too long, way too long. I think my upper bound is 20 minutes. Alex Tabarek said he likes to do 5 to 10 minutes. I think maybe 15 minutes is a good average to shoot for. I was slow in giving feedback because I was too busy creating content. My discussion forums were a total disaster. And that's one of the most important elements of online. So I really improved those. I didn't proctor my exam because we have a 3-week lead time, and wasn't ready until 1 week, and they said you're too late, so I had to do the exam on Blackboard. Ugh. Poor communication, poor organization in general. First off is about having quality content. I think this is the most important thing, and I did put most of my focus when I first set up this class on producing good content to engage the students. Providing quality feedback. This is where we get into the costs, to cost curve rising, because this is time intensive as well. And then cueing discussion to create that student engagement. Somebody in the last session asked about how do you create engagement. I think this is the key. And I think if you do this right, this doesn't have to be that labor intensive. I oversee a conversation amongst my students, and they're bouncing ideas off each other, and they're learning amongst themselves. It's a very magical process. But it's tricky to get the incentives right, so I'll show you. I'll be frank that this is, I think, still the weakest part of my class, the discussion aspect. And I'd like to, you know, if you had success with it, well, by all means, I want to know how you set it up, how you structure the point values, and how frequent, and what the grading criteria rubrics are, and all that sort of stuff. I think you do need to focus on these three things: quality content, quality feedback, and setting up the discussion properly. So I'm going to start off, and I'll talk mostly about content, actually. Online environment is so rich for producing lecture videos. You might as well, in fact, you need to take advantage of the media that are available, audio and video. So my audio is mainly my lecture, and, you know, I try to make that, and that's something that would be actually probably more fun and exciting in the classroom, because it's spontaneous. I can react to specific student questions, and I can pack in all my stories because I have an hour. In the online video, I don't do quite as much storytelling. I'm trying to get through it in 20 minutes. But that's not terribly different. But what I can add is music clips. And I started putting bumper songs on my videos. And I realized, well, I'm not just going to use elevator music. I'm going to use music that's themed to the topic. So in my unemployment video, I got a little clip of Blue Collar Man, you know, because he talked about waiting in the unemployment line. And, you know, some people might say, well, that's just window dressing, but I think that kind of gets the students prepped, gets them excited, maybe gets a little up-tempo music, gets them prepped to take in the lesson. Sound effects. I forgot to bring it. My wife gave me a little sound box that I use in the classroom that has sound applause, and it has a bell, and it has a, you know, the buzzer sound. Students answer the question right, I ring the bell. That's fun. It just keeps people's attention. Same thing in the online format. And then in video, use video, of course. Don't just talk. So I like to pack in pictures, as many pictures as I can. It's easy. Google image search. Movie clips is a big thing. And you can get anything on YouTube. saw, oh, there's, you know, a Simpsons episode, or there's a movie where they address this. I'm just going to excerpt the little piece of the movie with my Camtasia screen capture. I can just pop that right in. I can even do that after the fact. If I record a lecture video, I'm going to ask, oh, I should put this song at the beginning and end. I'll just pop it in after the fact. Oh, I should put a little movie clip in there. Just pop it in. Oh, I should show a picture in this lecture. I can pop that in. I don't have to re-record anything. I can go in and edit and just post overlay the picture with Camtasia. It's great. So there's really no excuse not to pack in the multimedia, and the students love it. Traditional, I think, and I think we are moving away from this, but I think a lot of online classes still have this look where it's just a camera in the back of the classroom, or it's a individual instructor with the camera set up in front of a whiteboard. And I'm not saying that's evil. Your typical lecture is 50 minutes or an hour and 15 minutes, which we're violating that attention span issue because you have to remember the students are online. They've got a lot of competing things, a lot of distractions. So this is not the way to do it. And you know, I think this is one of the MIT class. I'm sure it's an excellent class, top quality instruction, but not for an online setting. Here's some of my stuff, and I don't want to take the time to show the videos, but I just did some screen captures. When I do marginal value theory, I walk through the example from Carl Menger about the farmer and his different units of grain, and I show the table. And as I add the units, I populate the table, and I show a little picture, and then as I take away units to think about the changing value of the margin, I cross it off here, and I make this picture disappear. And then I have some little just funny elements in there, and the students really remember this. I can show them very real examples of things. This is very easy. I think I just took a picture. When I'm talking about money and banking and different kinds of deposit accounts, I want to differentiate demand deposits from time deposits. Well, shoot, let me show you a time deposit. Here's an old CD of mine. And I can really tell, wow, what the interest rate. And I go through, I just have a picture of this in my PowerPoint, and I highlight, here's the issuer, here's the maturity, here's the term, here's the face value, this interest rate. I walk through every element of this in the process of my video. In this video, I also have a really nice spreadsheet where I have bank A, bank B, bank C. We see when bank A issues a loan, it gets deposited in bank B, it's cleared through bank A, and that money multiplier process, and I highlight every step as I scroll through my spreadsheet. Here's a spreadsheet where I do a little price index. My goods are junior bacon, cheeseburgers, gasoline. These are kind of the essentials. Rent, iPad, and Levi's. And I walk them through, okay, quantities times prices, and we're going to weight them by the total amount of purchases. And wherever on the other side, I have the index calculated, and we do the changes in the price index. So, summary, I did 18 hours of video for this class. I think I have 30 individual lectures that I created, and I also have about 2, maybe 3 hours of other existing things. I use some of Alex Tabarrok's things on the solo model. I use Milton Friedman's inflation video from the Free to Choose series, and various little things like that I add in. That stuff is shared with my classroom course. Of course, the textbook readings are shared with the classroom course and the supplemental readings. So this is the main thing I added to do the online course, all my custom video content.